Hey guys, this is David Kwan, and yeah, this is yet another video on Genesis chapter 1, specifically again about the water above the earth verses in Genesis chapter 1, and I find them to be really interesting verses, which is why this is like my third video on the topic. But this video in particular, I want to kind of go over this theory called the water vapor canopy or the water canopy theory. Which is pretty much saying that there used to be water above the earth before the flood. Or there used to be water vapor surrounding the earth atmosphere before the great flood. So it's a theory that was proposed by, I don't want to say many, but some Christian scholars. There is a great amount, amount of controversy with this theory, even within the creationist circle, because there are a number of Christian scholars or creationist scholars or biblical scholars, who don't believe this water vapor canopy thing to be true. And there are those Christian scholars who believe it to be true. This vapor theory is totally an interpretation of the biblical verses, because after all, they're interpreting the word water to mean vapor in this interpretation, in this theory. It's a very interesting theory, and it rises from the verses that talk about water being above earth or the skies. So there's two ways to kind of interpret this. If we're only talking about Genesis, there's really only one way to interpret it. But if you're including maybe other books in the Bible, there's two ways to kind of fit that second interpretation in there, if you bring in other books. But if you're talking just about Genesis, and also other books in the Bible, this water vapor canopy theory is very compatible with the Bible, or just water above the earth thing. In the King James Version, it says God created the firmament, right? And then he divided the waters between the firmament. So he creates water. He makes it so that there is water below the firmament and above the firmament. In the King James Version of the Bible, God says he called the firmament heaven. Heaven. And in many cases, in the Genesis, the word heaven in that chapter, it seems like heaven means sky. So sky is dividing water from water. So there is water above sky and below sky. And that's King James Version. The New International Version uses the word expanse. So there is water above the expanse and below the expanse. And God calls the expanse heaven. And in some other versions, God called the expanse sky. So again, in both versions and many other versions of the English translation of the Bible, there is water above sky and there is water below sky. There is water. And this water in Hebrew is apparently meaning, does it literally mean the English word water? Not necessarily. It could mean many different things, but it's interpreted to mean something like, it's translated to mean something that is malleable, that is fluid, that can change, that has, you know, that moves fluidly. Which is why water is a perfect way to use that word, and also vapor might be a way to to translate that Hebrew word, but then we have water and vapor above sky and below sky. So this is the biblical rationale for this argument. Scientifically speaking, this argument is just really problematic. Let's talk about the biblical problem first. The first problem is the flood, right? So depending on how you interpret the happening of the flood mentions the bursting open of floodgates of heaven. And also it mentions, in the New International Version, it mentions the rupture of water above the firmament, or of water above the expanse. So the way to interpret it is there is water below the ground, and it just burst open. And there's water above the earth, and it just is ruptured, and it just pours rains down. there needs to be a ridiculous amount of water. It needs to rain, like, I don't know, like 300 meters a day for those 40 days and nights for the water to be able to be 20 feet higher than the highest mountains on Earth. This global flood, this global body of water that is higher, 20 feet higher than the tallest mountain on Earth, which we now know to be Mount Everest. So in order for that to happen, there needs to be massive amount of water. The canopy theory explains where that water came from. But then here's the question, where did the water go? We don't have that much water today anymore. Where did the water go? That's the problem with the canopy theory. It can't really explain how so much water disappeared and is no longer existing inside Earth today. After the flood, where did the water go? The canopy theory cannot answer this without raising some eyebrows. The other great issue, really big problem with this theory, is the atmosphere such a thing was caused. There's water vapor above Earth. In order for the amount of vapor that needs to be up there for the flood to have covered the world like that is pretty huge. So when you have that amount of water vapor above the sky in the Earth atmosphere, there are several problems that happens with that. The first problem is light absorption. Most of the sunlight cannot go through that kind of vapor. About 40% of it would be either absorbed or reflected off and go back into space. So only about 60% or less than that of sunlight will reach planet Earth or inside planet Earth. This really affects many plant life that needs to do photosynthesis in order to survive and thrive. How are so many plants able to thrive and survive with so much less light coming in through the atmosphere? That's one problem. Second problem is heat. With that much amount of water vapor, with that much pressure inside Earth, the planet Earth has so much hotter now. It's really warm now. So maybe that explains that. You know, a lot of Christian scholars use the water vapor theory to explain how human beings can live to be, you know, 900 or 800 years old because of the atmosphere. That might be the case. But most places on Earth now are going to be so dreadfully hot that it's big animals will not, you know, big birds that, you know, dinosaurs used to exist, pterodactyls, would not be able to fly high or, you know, things of that nature. It's just too hot for people to be able to survive in that kind of environment. Another thing is the vapor itself. In order for vapor to be existing like that, it needs to have, let me read here, I had a source for this, but the point of the source is that vapor needs to be moving at around the same speed or faster than the speed the planet Earth is orbiting in order to remain as vapor and not be, you know, liquid water. Or it needs to be like in colder, you know, something like that. But the speed at which the Earth orbits is really fast. It's like, I'm not sure on the exact figure right now, but it's like 17,000 miles per hour or some ridiculous speed. How is the vapor able to keep itself so speeding around Earth atmosphere like that in order to become vapor? So those are some of the problems that this water vapor canopy theory poses. Now, Christian scholars who are against this very idea because of the scientific improbability of such a theory, they like to interpret the Bible as meaning that the firmament not as meaning not sky but earth. So they like to interpret when it says water above the firmament, as meaning water above Earth and water below the ground. Scientifically, this makes much more sense, but literally, when we're literally interpreting Genesis, this really kind of goes against Genesis. You kind of have to bring some other books in the Bible to kind of tie in here. But again, the same question is, About the flood, it has to be mentioned. For the planet to be engulfed in so much water, so that water is 20 feet higher than tallest mountain on Earth, that's a massive amount of water. That is ridiculous amount of water. So does all that water go back to Earth? I have really high doubt that much water exists below ground right now. I really have strong doubt on that. After, you know, the Earth layer, it goes water, the ocean, the Earth crust, then there's some little waters below that gets, you know, that gets put up because of the water cycle. And then below that are molten lava layers. So there is no really water below the ground, unless you're thinking that lava is what Bible means by water. It could be interpreted that way. So there's multiple ways to interpret the word water, which is fluid thing that is malleable, that can shape. If you interpret water to mean lava, that could make sense. But here, what you're doing is you're interpreting the words in the Bible to fit the scientific observations that we made in the current world. You're kind of restructuring the Bible to fit along with science. That's what's going on with these scholars. It's these two theories, these two ways of interpreting the Bible are interesting, but both of them are not without problems. One, water vapor canopy theory is compatible with the Bible, but it's not compatible with science. The subterranean theory, that the water is above Earth and the water is below Earth, is compatible with science, but maybe, not as much. But it's not compatible with Genesis. So those are the two problems here with the water above Earth verses that I really wanted to talk about. If you have any questions, thoughts, opinions for or against what I've just said in this video, feel free to leave a comment in YouTube sections. I've always leave my comments open. Feel free to PM me, whatever. You know, I always find the discussions to be very interesting. Of course, you should know that my personal position is that I am an atheist. So this discussion about what the Bible means is simply a scholarly matter for me. It really doesn't, to me, I don't have a humongous personal stake as many Christians would do in this argument. But I do find to be very, very interesting and a very challenging debate on both sides. I personally think that if you're literally interpreting the Bible, it makes sense to go along with the water vapor canopy theory. But if you're going with science, then it doesn't make sense to go with that theory.